Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Antifa Unica.
With the Golden Dawn, who is going to be more extreme? So they have expressed their zero tolerance against immigrants first, of course. They have launched deportation against immigrants, which ironically or cynically was named after the Xenius Zeus, which was the ancient god of hospitality. They have inaugurated immigrant concentration camps, which of course don't call them concentration camps. They call them hospitality centers, where the immigrants are kept imprisoned without having found guilty by any court or facing any trial. Of course, the conditions in these centers are pretty bad. Characteristic is that a court in Goumenitsa city, which is a city in northwest Greece, has recently acquitted 15 immigrants who escaped from a police station where they kept imprisoned. And the reasoning for this decision was that it was a matter of dignity to escape humiliation, since they were kept imprisoned with other 13 people in 15 square meters without having access to open air and water. But the co-government has attacked also the anarchists. So they have evacuated many squads in Athens and in other cities and in the name of the law enforcement. Also, the police published again the photos of anarchist suspects in custody that they were digitally manipulated to remove signs of beating. And also the minister defended the release of the mugshots despite the digital doctoring, so that, as he claimed, the suspects in that way they would be recognizable by the public. Of course, the government continued and attacked the workers, so they have broken up the strikes of the workers in the Athens Metro and the tech hands by making use of an emergency law usually used during war time. Finally, they apply still, or even today, their extreme tactics to the local communities who are against their plans. So in Chalkidiki, Chris said some things before, the local people are against a project they want to a Greek Canadian company and the state to have there and to have their gold mines. There was an incident where there were burned some trucks of the company. If you want, after I can give you more information about all what is all happening in Chalkidiki. But the Greek police and the Greek state, because of this incident, for the first time, they legally collected DNA without notifying those taken into custody, why the genetic material was being collected and without any charge being made. Before they couldn't collect DNA at all. Then they revised the law and they could collect DNA just if somebody is sued for something. But this is the first time that something happening without any charges. So I would like to conclude that the rise of the Golden Dawn has given the opportunity to all this totalitarianism and fascism to emerge, and has affected all aspects of everyday life, and this is not a problem of some small groups like the immigrants, but it's a problem for everybody who, all those people think, all those the state or the Golden Dawn, fascist Nazis, consider that they are freaks. The anarchists, the leftists, the LGBTQ people, the women, the struggling workers, the struggling local communities, actually everybody except themselves, and they are exact clones.
Okay, on my turn, I would also like to thank you for inviting us here to the other side of the world and giving us the chance to strengthen the anti-fascist struggle. I believe that we live a global crisis, which through the no way out and the lack of perspective as a social sense, which intensifies rapidly, something that we can see very vividly in Greece. This crisis throws off its economic disguise and is exposed as a crisis of meaning. The crisis this time is synthesized not only by the decay and degeneration of ruling significations, but mainly from the uprise of new ones and the appearance of new social characteristics. I think that the outburst of information and the simplification of communications in all levels are some of them. So, the resolution of the crisis will hardly make it a bad memory parenthesis to the restoration of the old, but I think it will expose it as a transition to a new unknown social space. We can trace this transition, in my opinion, in two basic points. The first one is that normality is constantly redefined for the search of the meanings that will recreate the lost consent. The second one is that social time receives different quality. I imagine social time to be different than the personal everyday time, in aspect that personal time has a more linear way to deploy. I can imagine it as a constant continuity of the interaction of events and the meanings that they create. Whether the social time deploys more like a wave with peaks and downs, it may stick to the swamp of routine, or it can have intense periods of social creation or distraction. It's important to say that society moves in a different rhythm. As there is proliferation in the use of technology, and widespread information, it becomes more fluid in regards to social bonds and values. A lot of traditional bonds have broken, and strong values of the past have been recuperated or fallen apart. I think that we can see this picture very clearly in Greece. And finally, it shows biggest frequency in social moves. By saying social moves, I mean the procedures and institutions that define the social relations either from the top or from the basis. I think that the defeat of communism and bourgeois democracy as ideal and undoubtful fulfillments of history saw the crash of ideologies. To me, ideologies are necrologies about the death of God that happened in 1789 during the French Revolution. This crash removes the metaphysics of determinism and it gives meaning to social moves in the expanded present of needs and desires. This, of course, imposes a timing for freedom to gain space, but I think we can talk about it later in the discussion, more specifically. Metaphorically, we can connect this with the Golden Dawn by saying that metaphysics tries to get its revenge by giving a Machiavellian face to the state. In order to keep its theological relation with society, the state doesn't hesitate to breed and reserve totalitarian schemes, even if the memories of Auschwitz are still vivid. Fascism tries to sneak through the door of bliss, beyond the memory of Holocaust, with the help of wannabe princes in panic. I think that the monstrosity of Golden Dawn selflessly used the end of μεταπολίτευση in Greece. Μεταπολίτευση is the metamorphosis that took place after the end of Junta, as Vangelis said, the dictatorship, between 1967 and between 1974 it existed, the junta. So these metamorphoses turned into a bourgeois democracy and ended, in my opinion, in December of 2008, during the uprise. We consider the uprise of 2008 a decisive moment, literary and semiologically, that redefined the relation of the state and society. It altered them both and put Greece in the West for good. We could analyze December better later on through the discussion. So, on the border of the global transition from the traditional to the new that arises, specific significations of metapolitics, as I explained before, have collapsed, and especially after 2008, were stripped off as distinctive pole of a positive identification of a big part of society with them. We should speak about some of them in order to be able to map the new social space and understand better some original causes that gave birth to the abomination of Golden Dawn. I think that representation is one of them. As a basic column in representative democracy, we can see it suffer a deep crisis in all levels. One example is the world of labor at work, where syndicalism and trade unions are in deep doubt. At least in Greece it is so. Here we make a parenthesis to say that this, in my opinion, brings new possibilities for freedom, as we can see it through the example of Viomet, as Guy mentioned before, a factory that produces construction material which workers took over, and with no bosses and through self-organization, they make a horizontal and without intermediaries approach to the consumers. Another example is the rapid demise of the central political scene. I have to say here that the abstention rate in the last elections, the same elections that Golden Dawn took 7% and got into the parliament, the abstention rate in these elections was 40%, something that's very high for Greece. It was really low, former elections, the abstention rate. Another example is that on one of the main slogans in our demos, and especially during the Syntagma Square occupation, was burn the brothel of parliament. This slogan now is also one of the most popular among the fascists. We have to bear it in mind. In Greece, we could also see politicians to get verbally and physically abused and beaten and assaulted in the streets. And what we can say as a synopsis is that an individual feels there is nothing to be represented by. This also affects the institutions of integration, as the lack of trust towards them makes it more and more difficult for the state to recuperate society's confidence to its profit. So, the crisis of representation and integration creates a gap in the communication between society and state, opens a new political space to be claimed, and destroys the safety lines of a solid social contract. Another point we have to refer to is the end of the hedonistic view of growth in Greek society and the deflation of the Greek dream of social progress through university and specialization. People understand now that the great feast of overconsuming everything, material or non, is now over, and the fulfillment through a successful career haunts them as a nightmare, than inspires them as it used to. The new balance of powers that emerged to cover this overthrow has a more rational and calculative perspective, more faithful towards the early stages of capitalism, and more aware of the neoliberal example. I think that the new facelifting of authority creates in the border of collective responsibility. We must bear in mind here that this term, collective responsibility, was introduced by Goebbels, who was the secretary of propaganda of Hitler. So this collective responsibility enforces a national guilt that calls for sacrifices to be made, aiming to intensify development for the good of the nation. As we have referred to the word nation, we can trace here something important, in my opinion. The end titles for the end of history, as Fukuyama claimed, and the there is no alternative dogma, as Thatcher used to say, these end titles mask the ambition of defining economy as a natural order. This happens just after economy has failed to prevail, either through its ravishing attack to society by the neoliberal example dogma of Reagan Thatcher, or the Soviet model, which crashes in 1989. In order to gain the lost space, and be finally globally fulfilled, economy introduces the term of globalization. The creation of the sense of planetary village so that a global work site of time and space is formed has a serious side effect to the state itself. It burrowed under the foundations of nation, which from its birth is a main pillar of the establishment of the state, and it did this by encapsulating international into global. I think that music is an example that can give this to us, by the way that music as a primary language, this of feelings, is the first to do this as it displays the term world music instead of ethnic music as it used to be called. Of course, this challenge of basic lines in the multi-part canvas of globalization created cracks in the imaginary of growth and development, and the social contract with the state became more and more blurry. It's crucial here to say that social confusion that comes as a result from the above is a fertile ground for nation to be presented as a unified identity and protect itself and re-rise as an undoubtful element of truth. This is enhanced also by the death of social democracy, in my opinion. Even if it's still used as a fountain of solutions to the economic crisis, social democracy's core has been disintegrated. The social state, which stood as a father figure for society with its benefits, has been eliminated. The New Deal is just a story from the past, and Keynes' promises have fallen to the void. After it has lost the consent with the individuals, the state abandons them, that's very important for me, it abandons them, and tries to reinforce its necessity through the imposition of one-sided consent. It adopts the dogma, as Bush expressed it, everyone who is not with us is against us, and by constantly playing maniacally in the dipole of security and fear, it creates a constantly expanded state of exception. By state of exception, we mean that social parts with specific characteristics, such as immigrants, political and social moves and creations that defy the state and are born outside its example, unemployed, wasted, as they say, youth, people with amiable problems, etc., all these are excluded by authority to basic rights and are stamped by the label of not needed. The exclusion is getting wider, and it can also include whole communities, as we can see it in the case of a wartime attack that the regression forces made to the local community of Skouries in Chalkidiki, as Sophia explained before. So on this point, I think that authority drops its parental mask and stands in front of the individual, feeling no shame to appear as a punishing, heartless, imaginary figure. For example, this can be seen in the reflection that Europe had in Greece in regards to what it has now. Before the crisis, the European Union, who was still the sponsor and guaranteed prosperity, ensured for the petty bourgeois — the petty bourgeois was the huge former middle class of Greece — it ensured for the petty bourgeois a source of glamour, prestige and easy money, especially through the European support programs. At this time, the interaction with the other, and by saying the other, we mean here the immigrant, the foreigner, the one that comes from outside. So at this time, the interaction with the other is bearable and tolerated, as he is not an obstacle to the clientele relations and the insignificance of the overconsumption ideal. When austerity comes, and everything is binded with uncertainty, mistrust, and disbelief, European Union gets a strong sense of adversity and unhappiness. And suddenly the other loses his former symbolism, becomes a threat, can't be tolerated, and becomes unbearable. So in Greece, this sharp turn to find the lost security inside the borders is one of the causes why a non-racist society like Greece used to be, or to appear at least, can suddenly embrace neo-Nazi traces in its main political scene. A very important role also played, in my opinion, the development of an internal market in the neighborhoods and divisions of the city, in level of both needs and desires. I think this broke the old model of the division of the city in zones. Housing zone, production zone, consumption zone, management zone, and made proficient areas which enabled the political approach to the neighborhood. This, of course, is also very good for the forces of freedom, but it was also good for the fascists, who can't adjust the hate identity easily on the main political scene, but can do it in a more silent way in the microcosmos, as I say, of the neighborhood. We should add here that this decentralization and the rise of suburbia, in Athens especially, in the metropolis, emptied the center, which abandoned, gave home to the rejected. That's before the crisis. And after the crisis, it's reclaimed by the petite bourgeois. I think that we can't speak about a phenomenon if we speak only about the causes that gave birth to it, because action, which involves also rigid imagination that can't be analyzed, is also a main synthetic. So we have to see the interaction of these causes and the phenomenon they create in order to understand it more deeply. Even if it pre-existed, I think that Golden Dawn is a new political party, movement, with distinctive characteristics. First of all, I think it tries to make a social archaism and tries to mix nationalism and racism in an identificational way, and tries to achieve consent with class and racial characteristics, embracing the nationalistic part who wants civil development for the good of the nation, and also the deeply archaic one, who, even if he lives in multiracial societies many years now, has the illusion of a pure racial origin. I think that Golden Dawn has disproportionately to the worst organizing power in regard to the votes it takes and the imaginary it represents. For example, maybe it took 400,000 votes, but it cannot gather more than 100 or 150 for an action, and can't organize 1,000 people in Athens to be ready as an active environment. We know it for sure, because we confront them. This can also get explained by the deeply bureaucratic scent and apathy of modern person, something that is also bad, in my opinion, for the forces of freedom. I think that violence is the main value the Golden Dawn base their existence upon. They identificate violence with power, and violence becomes the ruling significance, which means it's the way according to them with which decisions are imposed, and the main way to claim space in the social political life. I think the events that also the guy said before, for example, with the slapping of a communist representative, which happened live in a television show, or the open market raids, all the examples that the guy said before can show this. We have to bear strongly in mind here that whatever excuse they make to hide it, they are Nazis. Okay, they are not just fascists, they are Nazis. They may appear a nationalistic face, especially after the elections, but their main aim is the extinction of everyone who doesn't fit in their irrational purity. In their sick minds, the possibility, however tiny it is until now, to be in power doesn't stop at the borders of Greece. Their main ambition is to expand, like Hitler wanted to during the Second World War, all over the world. That's why I think also, from my part, that they do moves like they do in the States or in any other place in the world. And they try to do this by setting connections with other right-wing psychopaths all over the world. But still, their basic target is to gain the streets in Greece. I think that's their basic target for now. Where violence can be a demolishing power to get social space. But until now they can't, because of the active antifascism. Very concerning is the fact that police are vastly into the Golden Dawn. E.G., as Vangelis said, the 50%, they got 50% in the elections from the police, and we know it because the cops vote in special election centers. That's why we know about the voting percent. It's true, this. And like he said, Diaz, the cavalry ones, the ones that do the dirty work in Greece, they torture people, and they have the most macho and anti-humanitarian attitude towards people. They have maybe 100% percentage in the golden vote, or 90, I don't know. An example about this, to make it to you be more understandable, is that in my hometown, Agrinio, a small town in the western part of Greece with strong left tradition, the Nazis can't really exist. They can't go to buy cigarettes without getting beaten, not only by anarchists, anti-fascists, either by radical fans. I have to tell you here that radical fans, fans of football teams in Greece, are strongly involved in anti-fascism action. It's an odd point for you, but it's true. For example, last week, these guys in my hometown, they tried to make an appearance in the central square of Agrinio. The cops, of course, surrounded them, circled them in order to protect them, because the anti-fascists immediately moved to give them their special treatment they always give. But the cops, who were surrounding and protected them, when the anti-fascists approached, drew their gun and aimed at the anti-fascists. That's totally strange and totally unbelievable for a small society like Agrinio. It's a closed society where something like this, you can't imagine to happen, because you meet everyone on the streets another day. So I think this is an example that shows the strong relation between the cops and the Golden Dawn in Greece. I also think that Golden Dawn took advantage of the movements where there were slow reflexes. The approach to the immigrants until then was messianic. They were the scapegoats that needed help in the same way that church helps its congregation. Syriza and the leftists had only made Syriza, the left party in Greece that claims power now, and the leftists had only made immigrants committees who in fact didn't mingle or interact with a community of immigrants, but only gave to the left political capital as pseudo-protectors. I would like to make a parenthesis here and share a thought I have during my visit to the States. First of all, I'm quite shocked with the level of segregation that still, in my opinion, exists in a social level, the way that radical thought and activism apply to heavily oppressed black or Latino communities indicates, in my observation, a lot of effort that has to be made to close this gap. And I also think that activists that have presence in either communities miss the chance to meet and interact with each other. Another interesting, in a very negative way, term I learned is the fourth world conditions concerning the indigenous people and the barbarism they suffer. I think the struggle of the indigenous for their land, their culture, their dignity, is a hard battle for freedom to be gained, and radical action should be connected directly to it. I think creative interaction between the communities would be a key point to smash conservatism and its values. This also applies to Greece and the relationship with the immigrants, as I think we should communicate in a higher level, socially, culturally, and by raising common actions. This more deep interaction appears in Greece in small steps, mainly in the anarchist anti-authoritarian action, which also was the core of the Antifa in Greece, I think. The anarchist anti-authoritarian action. I think it was the core. And in Athens and in the most of the cities. Anarchists were treating Golden Dawn as a minor matter until Syntagma Square occupation, when they appeared. They appeared mostly hidden. In a way that there was a Greek flag delirium in Syntagma Square this time that hadn't at all to do with fascism. It was that people demonstrated with Greek flags from all over the political spectrum. So they appeared hidden in this Greek flag delirium. All this, after the Syntagma Square, and of course after the elections, it immediately changed, as a white Antifa front was created and brought people with huge arguments and disagreements in the same table. That was a good aspect of it, of course. For example, I have to tell you that except the anti-fascist patrols in all the neighborhoods and the vast network of info centers to communicate the anti-fascist struggle, the guy said before, I can give you an example with a squad, Villa Malias. Villa Malias is a very old squad in Greece, was a very old squad in Greece, 21 years. It was evicted 2 months ago by the Cubs. Villa Malias was in the same place, close to Agios Pantelimonas. Agios Pantelimonas is a region, a division in Athens, through which the fascists tried to emerge. Because in Agios Pantelimonas, they used to live a lot of immigrants, and they tried to throw them out in order to gain space and give it back to the Greeks, as they said. So, Villa Malias was a clear obstacle for them to expand to nearby areas. And we saw that in practice. To sum up a bit, I think that if we are not alerted, what can really be a bubble and the farce of history through its immediate extinction, it can also be a black hole for freedom if we don't take the appropriate action we have to. I think that with violence, always as an option, and I hear always, it has two meanings in my point. The first meaning is that pacifism can't fit in the anti-fascist struggle. It can't fit in. Because fascism doesn't give space to dialectics, democracy, and generally any procedure that could include dialogue. The other meaning of always, that violence has always to be an option, is that it can never be, and we have to be really careful with this, it can never be our main significance. Because as Hannah Arendt said, the main significance of something, of a procedure, doesn't have to be explained, justified. For example, you don't have to explain or justify freedom. Violence, you always have to explain. You always have to justify. So I think that we should make strong communities of dialogue with creative and decisive character, which will allow freedom to arise and expand. The most important thing now is to be placed, these procedures to be placed in a social level. That's very crucial in my opinion, and the heart of social autonomy. What I mean by social autonomy is the action of society to self-define outside the state or any other divine intervention and create institutions based on solidarity, equality and freedom. We are parts of society, and our actions should be open-minded and inclusive. And I would like to close with these three points. Act up, don't respect authority, and smash fascism whenever and wherever you see it.
So before we enter into the Q&A, I'll hand it over to Colin for a quick announcement.
Yeah, hey, I'm Colin. I'm going to do the thing that's not super popular at like anarchist events. apparently I'm the right wing of the anarchist movement. Unfortunately for all of us, the struggle to make this shit irrelevant hasn't yet won. So one part of the event tonight is the aim to fundraise, right? We're trying to raise funds to battle fascism in Greece. It's very important. Thank you so much for the donations you've already given. I am going to give you another opportunity to give again. And for those of you that weren't able to on the way in, please do. I'm going to start passing this hat around. And, you know, just for, you know, thinking process on what we're giving, try and compare it not to a few bucks for an event that you go out to, but compare it to the difference between your ideals of battling fascism with maybe how much in a given year you give to a bar, or how much in a given year you buy with chocolates or go to movies. These are all just as important things for leisure, I understand, but they don't battle fascism in the way that we need to be doing. So please give.
Thanks, Colin. And also, we do have these shirts. We had these Antifa shirts, which we made with our own hands. We made, I think, over 60.
This is the reason that they are.
And we, what's that?
This is the reason that they are like this.
Yeah, yeah. We made they were, like, most of them were pretty good. And we were very proud of them. And we sold probably close to 60 in the past week. And so we just have the dregs left. And this is, they went much faster than we imagined, so we're trying to get more shipped to us. So we're accepting the donations for those anywhere between $5 and $20. So for comments, questions, to get some discussion happening, just jump in. Raise your hand. We'll just take one at a time just because of the language gap. We'll get the question or comment, let them discuss it, and then reply, and hopefully we'll get some momentum happening through that. Any comments or questions? Yes? And if you could speak up, if you can't hear in the when you have a comment or question, if it's quiet, I may ask you to repeat yourself, or I may repeat it for you.
My question is Golden Dawn growing, and if so, how fast is it growing? How fast is it gaining popularity?
Okay. Before the elections, they were pretty marginal. No, almost few people in Greece knew about them. As Vangelis said also, they had appeared in the political scene very few times. Although they had got, they managed to win in the municipality committee, let's say. They had one representative there of Athens. But very few people knew them. But they got the elections in May, they got a big percentage, and then also in June. But I think that it's also the impression they give that they are growing, mostly. Of course, they had, since they were, they are more powerful now because first, because they were elected in the parliament, they get a big amount of money, and also they get access to the public media, so their ideas are presented everywhere. And I think they try also to enter in the social media also. We heard in Montreal that they try to present that they had a demonstration of 30,000 people. That was never true in Athens. They didn't have so much demonstration, not even 5,000, less than that. They were about 1,000. So yes, I think that they try to, they use the propaganda to make impression that they are powerful.
I'd like to say that it's different, the powers that, something that Thanasis said, the powers that they can organize in the streets and how many votes they take. For example, okay, they go from 0 to 7%, but I don't think that they organize, they have more people to their actions, let's say it like this. This is one. Another thing is that, okay, what I think Golden Dawn is trying to do, and I think they can, they make it, is that they want to represent the people who are like this, who don't want, who used to vote for, they exist, they used to vote for New Democracy, and now Golden Dawn take them. The Nazis, the neo-Nazis, these people. So I think they will stay at 7%.
Yes.
Less.
Yes, I would also like to add that it's more than a reflection than reality, because you don't have to forget that, of course, they are populists. Every right-wing trust like this is populist one. So they present a different reality than the one that really exists, and they do it on their profit, of course. It's for sure this. And this reflection, I think you can see, because they make really, how to say, exaggerating things, like presenting all together in, today there was a trial of one of their leaders, Kastiaris, who was accused of battering a person and stealing his identity card, a leftist, in a university. There were, for example, witnesses for this, but of course, the charges were dropped, he is free. The court decided that there were doubts, so he couldn't get sentenced. And they appeared all together, 100 people in the court, to make an impression that they are a lot, but they are the most they can have. They can't have more. If anarchists, for example, in Greece, for a serious, very serious matter, something happens and they try to erase, there will be 2,000, 3,000 people in 10 minutes like this, through Facebook or through telephones. And it's true this. It has happened. Not only in December, where was another case, but in also things too. So I think it's a lie this, that Golden Dawn rises rapidly. It's an image that they create. And they try to communicate it through certain mainstream medias that support them. There are mainstream medias that support them in Greece, Thema and Diafora. And this is a false picture. And of course, that would be very nice for us, and I think it would help the main cause, this, if this was communicated also by everyone who gets this information through these events that are happening now in the States. I mean,
I'll take a mental stack, unless it starts getting too complicated. But before I do, I just want to add to this that the difference between image and reality with Golden Dawn, the image is inflated, but the reality it also is that they've won 18 seats in Parliament, which means that they now have also 7 million euros, which they used to buy weapons and police buy them from, and they use for their propaganda. So they do have some effective growth. So there was a question here. Jake, did you have a question? And then it was over there, and then you, and then...
So you guys mentioned that Golden Dawn has been opening offices in other countries, Australia, Canada, and the U.S. I'm interested, especially in the U.S., what have they been doing in these other countries, and are they engaging in politics in these other countries? Have they been engaging in politics in the U.S.? What does that look like? You know, I heard a rumor that they've been participating in anti-LGBT rights stuff in the U.S., but I've never really heard anything substantive.
Okay, I think that what they want to do is to inspire other. What we are doing, it's the same that they want to do. We want to come and say we have a movement, do the same, and try, you know, to make you and make by you to do more things. So I think they try to do the same in the U.S. First of all, of course, and they will. They will be involved in attacks and all these things because this is what they want to all the people do, all the movement, the neo-Nazi movement to do. We know that they fundraising, money for Golden Dawn in the U.S. I'm sure that they want to make some people to vote for them. You know, the Greeks that they are in the U.S. is more Greek than the Greeks that are in Greece. They feel more Greeks than us. So I think this is the best audience for such for nationalistic ideas to spread and racism ideas. So I think they have they try to make votes for, you know, for Greece. Greek people. The parties pay for the tickets to go and vote. I don't know if you know this. So, and another thing is that they won. How you call it in Greece? Because not legalization, the other word.
Legitimize,
because I use the other word. This is wrong. Legitimize themselves. I told this before. If they open offices in Boston, for example, and the people there don't say anything, they will come to Greece and they will say, okay, you people of the movement, of the leftist movement, the anarchists, said that we are neo-Nazis, but we are not, because in Boston they have no problems with us. We are okay. In Australia, the same. So this create a bad... This is bad for us. So if in these cities the opposite happen, they try to open offices, and the Greek community there, as they do in Boston, I think, in New York, send an announcement that they don't want them there, or the people try to close their offices. This is something that we can use. We can go to Greece and say, okay, they are neo-Nazis because everywhere they are going, nobody wants them because they are neo-Nazis.
So,
Yes, I would also like to add something to it. I agree totally with Vangelis. And to give an example, they were in New York. We learned that they tried to make an office through a church, an Orthodox church, that gave them space to express themselves. But after the intervention of the Greek community there, as Vangelis said, they made a text that they were against, an announcement that were against it. The Greek church nearly dropped its interest to hospitalize them among in its place because, as they said, they didn't know. So they tried to exploit, for sure, the Greek communities all over the world and to play with the brackets pain that they are not in the country for long and all these things, with ignorance also, and play with also their ignorance. So I think it would be important to communicate it. It's okay because it's more a bit, it has some more specific characteristics when we speak about the Greek community regarding with the Golden Dawn, because it's in Greece. That's why I say about the Greek community. That it has to be spread all over. But I say specifically about the Greek community because it's an element that they will try to take advantage of. As they tried to do this in Canada, in Montreal, they also tried to do something like this. So I think that to not let them, as we said before, is not only something that will make them decline, will cut a connection for them. It's also strong for the anti-fascist movement and the force of freedom who try to fight back and eliminate this thing.
I'll just mention that this video that you're seeing right here is the street level clashes between the anti-fascist motorcycle patrols and the police. The police are firing flash grenades that send fire and they swirl around, and so that's what the big bangs that you see. So we had a question or comment in the front row section here on the side, and then the third row back here, and then the far section over here, and then we'll take more after that.
You might have to cut it after that, just in terms of
time. Okay. Are we running a tight?
We're supposed to be at 7 minutes, but we can stretch it.
7 minutes.
Whatever you want.
Ooh.
Let's break the law.
Let's break the law.
I just wanted to real quick mention that so far tonight we've come up with $822.
Woo! This is the most so far of donations. The most.
Bravo.
Wow. I also wanted to ask, a week or two ago, there were two or three stories, articles on the internet from news sites saying that there had been some sort of foiled plot by the sections of the military against the parliament, some sort of coup plot that was nipped in the bud or whatever. And the stories that have sort of been on the internet were very sort of not particularly detailed. The information was kind of sketchy. And I wondered if you wanted to comment on that, the accuracy of that, and also how it might relate to the stuff you talked about how a large percentage of the police and military voted for Golden Dawn.
Yeah, okay. I think it's true that a lot of a big part of police, especially, are into Golden Dawn. We said this before, but you know what happened because of the whole chaotic order in Greece that doesn't match chaotic with order, but it's like this, a twist. They try to enforce false dilemmas. For example, this dilemma between drachma or euro that you maybe had read before that it existed in a pro-election time in Greece as a main matter. It wasn't like this. Very few percentages really spoke about drachma. It was for several reasons that either Syriza or New Democracy, for its benefit and for its on behalf of its growth and winning the elections, they cultivated to the Greek society. So I think that there were. It's also this a kind of something that really didn't happen this.
You speak about black waters.
No. Yeah.
Okay.
The chances. You said about Blackwater or the Who that was...
I didn't mention Blackwater, but that was...
Yeah. Okay, this is something that extreme right-wing guy published in Greece. I think it's, another scenario of conspiracy. He has no... I tried today to find something about this. It's only... Αυτός με το χωνιμό, σου λέω. Ναι, he's a nationalist, he tries to find, the national traitor, so something like this. So I don't believe that there's something in this, really.
Leftist,
right?
Let's try to get some more questions before we have. Yeah, go ahead and then...
All right. So I was wondering, to what extent is Golden Dawn like actually attacking LGBT communities, things like this? Is there violence? What's being done about it? That sort of thing.
Okay. Anyway, in Greece, the conservatism is too high anyway. So people don't accept the different people. This is a reality. But Golden Dawn does what many people were thinking that they would like to be done. It's done by Golden Dawn. So we have many attacks to LGBTQ bars, or randomly people that they go to areas nearby these bars, they have been beaten by them. So what we did is, first of all, we tried to have a connection with this movement, the LGBTQ movement, in the anti-fascist struggle, and we try our patrols to go to these areas too. So they don't, the fascists can't sit there waiting for someone to... This is the thing that we do in the streets. I think the most important is a little bit with to work a little more harder with the society, to change their minds about people generally. For example, okay, Corpus Christi, the theater that they tried to stop, it was blasphemous because they represent Jesus as bisexual. This was the whole issue, and
I also think that Greece is homophobic society. Because there is a strong mixture of patriarchy and Orthodox Christianity that's left. So I think it's totally homophobic society, and not only the Golden Dawn. I mean, for example, listen to this, that a guy from Syriza, the Golden Dawn told him that he was a gay, and he replied back, me gay, the one that I am a guy that has fucked half Athens. So he tried to, yes, he thought that it was something intimidating for him. He belongs to Syriza, the left party that tries to gain power now in Greece and competes with New Democracy. I think that shows that something more deeply rooted to Greek society that has to be grown out, And unfortunately, you can see some attitudes like this even among in anarchist spaces. That a lot of macho guys who try like to throw rocks to the cops and smash and throw molotovs and all this shit, when it's good to do this, but when they come to political sense and they try to speak about equality and basic points that of course they don't allow you to be homophobic. You can't be homophobic. How can you be homophobic and speak about freedom? It's something that doesn't suit one with the other. But unfortunately, they are in this mood in Greece. And I think that's the fortunate thing is that this starts slowly to change because of the interaction with the LGBTQ community that's stronger in the last years.
Okay, so we'll take this question over here, and then I guess we'll reevaluate and see what's possible.
So I just don't, I'm going to be the money guy again. I I know that there are a number of like ideological organizations, social movement organizations, like broader political or community organizations represented in the room right now, who might have maybe slower decision-making processes, or just you know are inspired by this moment. Is there a way for us to donate to you to this tour and to the larger struggle if it's like after this?
Right now, there's a website called The New Significance, which I'm an editor of, thenewsignificance.com, and on the homepage there's a series of links where people can donate anywhere between $5 and $1,000 that will go towards this tour and also solidarity efforts in Greece. So it'd be great if you could visit the website, make a donation, spread it around, really help. I mean, this is our first week on the tour, like our ninth event. We've got two more weeks to go, so we really need support for the next while.
Can you repeat that website?
Thenewsignificance.com. Okay, what do you think? Okay.
Yeah, as soon as the door, we should probably stop. But.
Okay, there's one in the back. Yeah.
Try not to ramble, but first off, as
a little bit.
Speak up, please.
Okay, sorry. I'll try not to ramble, but first off, as a Greek person in the U.S., this means so, so much to me, and everybody's support here means so, so much to me, and thank you so much to the people putting this on. Watching what's happened in Greece has been, you know, alternately inspiring and really, really frightening when it comes to Golden Dawn. And just to make a few comments, I think it's important that people know that people across New York State have been paying attention to what's going on in Greece. When the uprisings in 2008 happened, there were really wonderful actions in Rochester. There was a march in Syracuse that had people from Oswego, Rochester, Syracuse, all over the place in upstate New York. And recently also we've had a spate of different fascist organizings happen in the, you know, upstate and western and central New York State. So, you know, this fight is also our fight here. And in a lot of the instances, there was one instance where neo-Nazis in upstate New York in Albany wanted to attack a pride parade. And they were thankfully stopped and physically stopped by Antifa folks then. There's also been more recent times where anarchists and Antifa have not been able to shut down Nazis in our area. The police have protected them. You know, one fascist speaker who was speaking at a hotel in Syracuse, people told the hotel that this was a Holocaust denier. The hotel did not care. People were kicked out by the police. This is right here. This is right now. This is our fight, too, and it's so, so important that we don't see this as something happening elsewhere. And I want to try not to ramble, so I'm going to let things go, but thank you so, so much.
Thank you.
Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on.